Guys, I'm really excited to be here talking to you. My name is Cole. I'm a storyboard and writer on Adventure Time. So today I wanted to talk to you guys about how we come up with our stories for Adventure Time and the process from coming up with them to all the way to when they're storyboarded, and we'll take a look at some finished episodes and sort of you'll be able to trace the lineage and then get a better feel for how we make our episodes in television. A little bit about myself. I graduated from here in 2003. Afterwards, I went to CalArts. I got my bachelor's in character animation. And while I was at CalArts, I interned at Cartoon Network. A cubemate of mine, JG Quintel, who created Regular Show, he had done the internship some years previous and had suggested that I do it. And so he was sort of the the main thrust of me going to Cartoon Network. And so the nice thing about that internship is that it really gives you a chance to display your ability. At the end of it, you do a 7-minute pitch to the network and the executives and all of the creators and heads of the TV shows. So after my pitch, Thurup Van Orman, who's the creator of Flapjack, approached me and asked if I wanted to do storyboards for his TV show. And so while I was at CalArts in my junior year, I started working on Flapjack. So I was going to school full-time and working full-time, and there aren't that many hours in the day to do both. So it was crazy. But graduated from school, and after Flapjack ended, I moved on over to Adventure Time. So I just wanted to open up quickly. Like most of you guys have a familiarity with animation, and I brought this video along. It was made by Cartoon Network to sort of show people that have no idea what animation is. But it's really cool because it gets you like some visuals on what it's like to be there and like who are all of the people that are making the shows. Also, the humor in it is like a little, I'll say it, it's a little corny. So I might have some like additions and like some corrections to it. So it's called Cartoons, Are They Magic?
Could this napkin sketch of a cuddly woodland character capture the hearts of children and adults around the world? Let's find out how it could happen. Follow along now to discover Cartoons. Are they magic? In the early stages of cartoon pre-production, writers sit around a table and pretend to work for weeks until a script is due. Then, illustrators expend most of their department budget on cutting-edge post-it note technology. The drawings they produce are assembled into storyboards, which are like cut-rate comic books that illustrate key frames of the script. When storyboarding is complete, voice actors are called in to perform precise comic improvisations.
Oh, what?
You're wrong! You're all like, that'll never happen. And then we'll get all cool, and you'll be all like, whoa, and then we'll be like, in your face! And then I'll be all like, get back to work!
Grown men can actually make a living performing voices just like these. The voice recordings are then synchronized with the storyboards, resulting in an animatic, or a movie where the images don't move at all. Finally, the director will make notes on everything from the animatics to set modeling and sheet timing, during which handwritten notes are actually made with a pencil, before the whole package kicks up its heels for an intercontinental flight. A flight to sunny South Korea. A conference call helps both teams iron out technical details, like how to do the running man or the cabbage patch. Then the Korean team will do all the actual work. Dozens of artists will labor carefully to create everything between the keyframes featured in the storyboards. Then all drawings are scanned, inked, and painted before arriving at animation layout. It looks like this little birdie is ready for his close-up. After review and retakes by the Korean team, it's homeward bound for our little cartoon, where final edits and sound mixing put the finishing touches on a precocious new feat of animation.
Step off!
Mm-hmm. So now you know what we know, and we'll leave it up to you. Are cartoons magic? At Cartoon Network Studios, we like to think so.
Okay, cool. So it's mostly regular show. I work on Adventure Time, that's a different show. But so that part where he was talking about how we use the latest Post-it technology, that job is a storyboard artist. I'm sure most of you know that, and that's what I do. So I'm gonna go ahead and just, we'll go ahead and take a look at the process for how we come up with our ideas. And the ideas for the show really begin in the writer's room. I brought some writer's games, and I'll explain what those are in a minute. Normally, we'll get most of the ideas from the writer's room and the writer's games that we play, but sometimes, like, somebody will bring in an idea that they just want to make an episode about. Penn has a story about how he was at Comic-Con, and he was signing autographs, and it was getting pretty late. It was getting dinner time. And he's like, okay, there was still a crowd of people there. He's like, okay, I'm sorry, everybody. I got to get going. I got to go. I got to eat. I'm sorry, and he started backing away. And then one woman just furiously busted through this crowd of kids and went, Penn, sign your autograph! Sign my paper! Please, 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 please! And Penn was just looking in horror, and he was just like, ugh, unsure, and she just looked at him and was just like, please, 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 please! And Penn just freaked out, and he was like, okay, all right. And he grabbed the piece of paper and, like, signed it and gave it to her and just, like, backed away and, like, ran off. And so that ended up becoming the basic idea for an episode we did called Davy, where Finn, he ends up, like, battling this dragon, and he, like, destroys it in a really cool way, and everybody in the Candy Kingdom sees, and they're like, whoa, Finn, you're totally awesome. And people come up to him, and they're like, sign my paper, Finn! Sign my rock, Finn! And then one guy comes up who's voiced by Penn, and he's like, please, 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 please! The whole episode is just so that could happen. No. Sometimes there's, like, a little bit of, like, personal reflection in the episodes. So to backtrack a little bit, the writer's room. Most of the storyboard artists, when we have an offsite meeting, most of the storyboard artists, I should back up, offsite is when all of the people who write on the television show get together and we all come together so that we can make TV ideas. And we do that offsite, out of the writer's room, out of the normal writer's room. So the storyboard artists come along with the regular staff writers, and we all sit around at a table, and we take a piece of paper like this, and we fold it hamburger style two times, so that when you're done, you have four folds in the sheet of paper, and we start to play a writer's game, and they end up looking like this. Let me zoom out a little bit. So in this writer's game, each you have a minute to depict some. You have a minute to depict one of the three acts of the episode, and you have a minute to depict an image up at the top. So it'll start by, like, one person will get the outline. They'll start by just making a drawing up top. They'll have 1 minute. They can be anything. We'll just take a quick look here. There's people drew Simon, Marcy, and PB. Somebody drew, like, Finn and a brain, sleeping, Finn riding a bird, screaming. And you use that as your jumping off point for what the episode would be about. So after that minute is up, you pass the paper to your right, and another storyboard artist gets it. We set a timer for a minute. And then really quickly, we just try and write what we think that first act is about. So you just take a look at the picture and you're like, okay, I guess this is a story, my guess. And you just write down whatever comes out of your mind. And then the buzzer goes off, we pass it to the right, person does second act, third act, and so on. So I wanted to read some of these to you because sometimes you can get some really cool stuff and sometimes you can get some, like, stuff that's like, weird. Oh, yeah. Oh, so you probably already read most of it. All right, so this first one, there's just a bunch of eyes up top. And the person who got Act 1 wrote, Finn and Jake find a mysterious wall with lots of mysterious holes. What are they for? Where did this wall come from? They try to make the holes bigger, but it won't work, and they're too small for Jake to fit in. So they start walking around the wall, but they just get back to where they started. So they finally look in the hole, and they're shocked to see something amazing. And the person who got the third act brain farted and just wrote cheese grater? Yeah. And this next one, we've got PB and Marceline, and PB is giving Marceline this wrapped package. And in the background, you see Finn, and he's got like this shocked expression. And he goes, Finn thinks PB and Marceline are making money on the black market. He doesn't know what they're doing, but he thinks they've fallen under the influence of the bad element of the Candy Kingdom, Dr. J. And then this word, illegal hijinct? I don't know. Hijinks. This guy. He tracks the movement of the package from Candy Kingdom to Candy Kingdom, from court royalty to the seediest gigolo haunts. No one is opening the package, but everybody who touches it begins to grow huge. Pretty soon, Finn and Jake are the only normal-sized weirdos anew. Dr. J confronts Finn and tries to make him touch it, but he won't give in. Jake gets big without touching the box and kicks the crap out of Dr. J, then the spell is released. Sometimes that's where you gotta go with it. And so we'll find just a couple more. Oh, okay. So normally in these work sessions, or in these writers' games, we're just like trying to figure out anything. Like we'll just pull for anything for inspiration. And Penn has this phone app that it says starting work session, begin, and like it's just this horrifying, like terrible voice. And so like I got this one. I just drew this like this old like IBM computer with like a whip, and Finn and Jake are like digging a hole, and it says starting work session. And handed it off to somebody, and they were able to come up with an outline out of it. It says, one morning, Finn and Jake are awoken by a screeching robot who whips them till they get out of bed. He whips them over and over as they brush their teeth and dress. He wants them to be the best they can be! Finn and Jake have crazy muscles and brains, and now from all... Oh, brains now from all the forced work, work and learning, but they're really stressed out. The robot accidentally breaks his whip, and while he's trying to repair it, Finn and Jake sneak off and find BMO, who's like, oh, hey guys. And they're like, hey dude, you're a robot, talk to this guy. And BMO's like, oh. And so BMO goes to talk to the robot, who's finished repairing his whip, and he's like, back to work, continue session. And now BMO is working with Finn and Jake and getting crazy muscles. Finn and Jake have had enough and refuse to do more work. The robot says, fine, it's your life. Finn and Jake become lazy and fat. In the end, we reveal BMO has stolen the other robot's whip, and he grins maniacally to himself. Oh, Finn and Jake. So the point I'm trying to make here is not all of these are winners. yeah, so that's the basis for a lot of episodes. At that point, you know, this is just something to get things generated and going, just to get ideas stirring. And at that point, it's handed off to the writers who take these really like rough outlines, and they're involved. They have to like sort of structure it into something that makes sense and something that has like a narrative that you can follow. And so we'll take a look at the next part here. Which is outlines. And so really what they're trying to do is they're trying to instill, underneath all this, there's a very basic structure. And it's that you have these characters, Finn and Jake, and they just start out normally as they are every day in life. And by the end of first act, something comes along and happens to them. It's a problem that they have to solve. And it isn't a problem that they can go back Or, I'm sorry, it isn't a problem that they can ignore, it's something that they need to address. and then the second act is them figuring out how to solve this problem. They go off to a faraway land, they have to Jake is really distracted and he has to overcome his distraction in order to find his lost buddy Finn. And that's what they do throughout the second act. And then by the end of the second act, there's usually a sort of a twist, or they find out that the thing that they thought was going to solve the problem doesn't solve the problem. And so they have to do a new thing for the third act, and that third thing that they do in the third act ends up solving the problem. So that's the basic sort of skeleton for each one of these episodes. That's the basic driving force behind each of these. Everything that you see, like the details, the characters, those are all important to the story, but they're not the essential component. It isn't the thing that makes you gravitate and comprehend an episode. So Adventure Time is set, a lot of people think Adventure Time is very like surreal and very random, but it's not, it's very structured. It's a fantasy environment, but those are all like what's on the outside. Those are all what's sort of the details and the fun and the humor. What allows you to watch something is that you're watching these characters trace and go after this one goal. Because if it was truly random, it would just be like a series of image collages that you wouldn't be able to follow and you would turn off instantly. So this here in Act One, this is an episode I worked on. This is a two-parter. I storyboarded it with Jesse Moynihan. And I just wanted to show you quickly, we'll transition over to what happens when the storyboard artist gets the outline. And I just wanted to read this first act and sort of, I'll go ahead and talk about it afterwards. It says, above the candy glass entrance to the red and white frosted candy kingdom. Oh, I'm sorry, you need a little bit of setup. This is the second half to a two-parter. What's happened in the first half is the Lich has battled, or Finn has battled the Lich. And during the course of this battle, Princess Bubblegum is dropped into this vat of ooze, and she's badly burned and sort of like jacked up. And the Lich is defeated, it's actually the Ice King that drops in Princess Bubblegum into the vat of ooze. And so Finn and Jake are like super upset with the Ice King. So this picks up with them going to the emergency room to revive Princess Bubblegum. So this is the original outline. This isn't what was in the episode per se. It says, above the candy glass entrance to the red and white frosted candy kingdom confectionery medical center, aka confection med, a licorice sign glows red. Candy emergency! Inside, doors slam open as Finn, Jake, the Ice King, and the top candy doctors and nurses, including Dr. Ice Cream, Dr. Donut, Dr. Princess, Plump Gruff Nurse Pound Cake, and Nurse Wax Lips, rush with badly melted Princess Bubblegum on a gurney. Dr. Ice Cream, how's her flavor? Nurse, what is WL again? Wax lips. It's fading fast, doctor. Dr. Donut, flavor IV, push, stat! As the gurney slams through the countless doors, Finn and Jake and the Ice King trade the blame. Finn says, it's your fault, because you dropped her! And Ice King says, yes, but why was she there? Because you brought her there! In the flashback, we see the Ice King accidentally drop PB into the Lich's chemical pool, as the Ice King claims in the voiceover that he wouldn't have kidnapped PB if Finn and Jake hadn't given them their blessing to marry. Finn, so we should have given you our blessing to prevent you from hurting her? Ice King, exactly. That was what was originally given to us in the outline. And so Jesse and I sort of felt that there was too much back and forth between all of the doctors and all of the all of the medical talk, and it sort of got really confusing and sort of convoluted. And so we decided to streamline a lot of that down. We also wanted to tone down a lot of the sort of like the overt anger. Like, we still wanted to keep a way for Finn to feel angry, but to not have him threaten death on the Ice King. And so we ended up just toning it back. We added in a couple of things to make it a little bit more, I don't know, palatable. So I'll go ahead and just play you the first act from that episode that we storyboarded, and you can kind of see how it differs. This is a work print, so it doesn't have full sound effects.
Hold on, my love.
What's her condition, Dr. Ice Cream?
She's totally gross over 90% of her body. The other 10% is crazy nasty.
Will she make it, Doctor?
I don't know, Nurse Poundcake.
Her vital signs are low, Doctor.
Put sugar on her. 2 scoops. We're losing her.
No, not my number one. Princess, if you die on me, I will never forgive you. I'll be lost. Lost in my own emotional labyrinth.
Yeah!
Wait, Finn.
What?
Her sugar levels are stabilizing.
She's all right! She's all right!
You're alive. Yes.
This happens all the time in storyboarding. You throw out ideas constantly, even when you're at the finished stage, even when you're about to turn it in, you end up finding out that you need to redo an entire section just because something isn't working right, or the idea is too weird, or whatever the case may be, and you can't ever really get too precious with your ideas. So Jesse and I boarded an episode called Death in Bloom, and it's where Finn and Jake go to the underworld, and they are trying to recover this plant that Princess Bubblegum needs from the underworld, because they kill it. So the original version of the board, I guess I'll just pitch you the first act, and then I figure we could just sort of lead out, and then we can just watch that episode so you can see how it varies. This episode was originally called To Remain a Lady. It's a way different premise. So it starts out at the Candy Kingdom, and Princess Bubblegum walks out onto the balcony, and one of the Candy Kingdom people plays a trumpet, bom, bom, announcing her arrival. Princess Bubblegum walks out to the balcony. Good citizens, I am off to the Veggie Village for their annual technology fair. And everybody cheers, yeah, yeah, throwing confetti everywhere. Princess Bubblegum says, never fear, my subjects. For I will return on the morrow. On the morrow, on the morrow, everybody says. On the morrow, on the morrow. Finn and Jake, come with me. And they walk off screen. Finn, okay. And we wipe. And Jake's there and he's looking at this watch that doesn't exist. And he's just kind of smacking. You're the only two I trust with this job. I'm assigning you to a task of utmost importance while I'm away. And they're walking through the Candy Kingdom. And Jake's like, Friend's excited. Give me the deets. In here. And she walks in this elevator. Choop. And the elevator shoots up the side of this building. And they get out and they walk away. And Princess Bubblegum points and the camera pans down to this plant. There, the halo lily. You must watch it for me. And Jake goes, only one halo lily is born every 108 years, Finn. Its pollen has a special property that regulates my lady levels and keeps me super princessy. And Finn covers his mouth, and he's like, your lady levelists are super awesome, princess. Yes, and I want to keep it that way, okay? And Finn says, whoa, PB, and he puts his arm on her. He says, I'll protect this plant and your lady levels with my life. And you, Jake, gives a thumbs down, and Finn pops into shot, points to his eyes, points to Jake's eyes, points back to him. I need this, bro. I'm psyched, let's do it. All right, you two, ha ha. Jello. And then the Princess Bubblegum walks away. I'll be back on the morrow. And she turns around, scree. And this falcon from the sky just drops down. We see it drop down and grab Princess Bubblegum and screech off into the corner. And Princess Bubblegum grunts. She gets on top of the falcon. Whoops. Take care of my plant. We will, princess. Dude, we are going to rock this. And they go over and they go next to the plant. And Finn grabs the plant. Oh man, we are going to treat this plant like a best friend. Yeah, dude. Yeah. Get ready for the best taking care of your life, Halo Lily. And Finn gives it a little kiss. We wipe. And we cut, and they're inside this candy kingdom, and they're like partying with these huge speakers going on, and they're dancing up and down. And Finn's like, watch this, Halo Lily. Hey, he wants to dance too. And he grabs the plant, and he kicks off the bass to it. And he grabs the stems to the plant, and he starts dancing with them. Woo, woo, woo. And Finn's like, ha, yeah, yeah, yeah. And we cut to inside, and they're sitting at this table, and they're all eating pizza. And Finn looks over at the plant. And Jake stuffs a cookie into the base of the plant, and they stuff a pizza into the base of the plant. And they stuff cookies and pizza into the base of the plant, and Finn pours cola, Jake pours cola into the flour. Finn stuffs a pizza in there, and they're both like, yeah, and they high-five each other. And the plant like leans over and like dies. And then we go to the bathtub, and they're putting it in the bathtub, and they're washing it, and the water gets all gross and brown, and all these pepperoni pizzas float to the top. And they clean it off, and they dry it, and they're like, yeah, and they high-five each other. We cut to this crackling fireplace, and we cut wide, and they're all laying down. And Finn's reading a book, and he says, and then the monster got punched in the head. And the princess was safe, and Jake kind of goes off to sleep. And everyone was happy. And Finn looks up, and we see the plant burning. And it's on fire. Finn and Jake pop into screen, and they pat it all down. And then they lean in, and the plant's all burning and sizzling. And Finn leans in and puts a Band-Aid on it, kisses it, and they high-five each other. And they go in, they're laying this plant down. They're like, time to lay down, beautiful buddy. And they lay him down, and Finn sighs. We killed it, man! And he's like, I know! Princess Bubblegum is gonna turn into a dude-like. It's okay, man. We can get an identical one and switch it out. No way, dude. This is the only plant that can control princesses' lady levels. Oh yeah, the answer is simple, Jake. We must travel to the land of the dead to steal the flower's soul and bring it back to life before Princess Bubblegum returns. Okay. And Peppermint Butler comes in. So it's a completely different beginning. There's also huge sections of this that are crazy different. I'll just glance through them really quickly, and then we'll go ahead and just watch the episode, and we can see how it turned out. There was, at one point in this episode, there was a rabbit that led them through the underworld, and this rabbit got completely wiped out of the board. It was about 20 pages that were like completely gone, mostly because it was something that was extraneous. Like, they had a mission, and they could follow it themselves. They didn't need this rabbit there to sort of pilot them around. And then the one joke from this is that the rabbit wasn't actually a rabbit. It was like a dude in a little skeleton inside of the rabbit. So Finn gets really upset at the rabbit because it betrays him. And he's like, I thought you were our friend. And he shakes it really hard. And the skeleton dude drops out of the bottom of the rabbit and hits the ground. Ugh, hello. Ugh, why did you do this to my friend? After you drank from the river, I was going to eat your flesh. Never! And Finn socks him, starts beating him up. Wait, 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 don't beat me up. I can take you to death. He can help your friend. And the flower. And Finn's like, ugh, show me where death is. And you best not be jiving me this time. He's like, no way, man, I ain't jiving you. And he rips off his head and takes off. And they walk off. That's all gone.
Owe me something in exchange for that favor I did.
Sure, yeah, what is it?
I'd like your flesh.
Quit being silly, Peppermint Butler.
I'm going to take it from you while you sleep.
Thanks for coming. I appreciate you guys coming to listen to me. I'll see you around.